People say to me, have mercy. Have mercy.
A Tony James podcast, and I got a special little treat for you in this episode. We're going to be talking about hardcore wrestling, and we're going to be talking about tag team wrestling, but I've got someone driving the mothership today. Come on in. Hey.
What's up?
We got Jimmy Fahrenheit.
What's up?
So Jimmy Fahrenheit's going to be joining us today on the podcast. We're going to talk hardcore wrestling. We're going to talk tag team wrestling, right? And it's The Good, the Bad, and the Wrestling, a Tony James podcast. Now let's get to work.
Yeah.
Check out the best in independent wrestling. Check out the Premier Wrestling Alliance. That's PWAOhio.com. You can find them on YouTube. You can find them on Facebook. You can find them on Instagram. That's PWAOhio.com, the Premier Wrestling Alliance. And coming up in July, live Saturday, July 15th at the Fairfield County Fairgrounds, Lancaster, Ohio. Huge event. I'm talking very big. Sam Houston will be defending the PWA U.S. heavyweight title against Handsome Nick Hamrick, who's bringing along his manager as always, A. Dick Vickers. That is just one of many matches that'll be going down on Saturday, July 15th. Once again, that is Premier Wrestling Alliance, PWAOhio.com. Check them out. Hey, this is the Good, the Bad, and the Wrestling, a Tony James podcast. And as always, the bells of justice are ringing. And if you don't hear the bells of justice, don't worry, my friends. Justice will always ring when we're talking about the Good, the Bad, and the Wrestling. Today, as I said, I got a very special guest, Jimmy Fahrenheit. Thanks for coming in, Jimmy.
What's up, Tony? Thanks for having me.
It's been a while since we've gotten together and talked wrestling.
Right.
So I do appreciate you penciling me in your schedule. I know you're a busy guy. Coming in here, we're going to talk a couple things. We're going to talk hardcore wrestling, and we're going to talk tag team wrestling. The first thing I want to do, though, if I could, I'd like to talk just briefly. And I'm talking briefly about independent wrestling. I wanted to get your take on something.
Yeah. What's
up? So I've been, as I do, I watch a lot of independent stuff. I watch a lot of Midwest, a little bit of West Coast, and a little bit of East Coast, but. What I'm starting to see is an interesting trend in independent wrestling, and it's on the fans' end.
Okay.
I'm getting from the fans, they don't like crappy wrestling anymore. Do you agree?
You mean like the wrestling that's so bad it's good?
Yes. Yeah. That used to be cool.
I mean, it was okay.
From a fan's point of view, people would go watch that because
I wouldn't want to see it every show.
No.
If I got one, maybe every few months. Okay.
Yes.
Just give me a little giggle, I guess.
So yeah. I've just, as I watch posts, as I watch quality of match, and as I watch attendance, I believe there was a time probably from maybe 2012 to maybe 2018 or so, fans tolerated.
Yeah.
Crappy wrestling, if they knew they were going to get one or two good matches. I'm getting the sense now that we've transitioned out of a stagnant state and everything's up and rolling again. Mm-hmm. They're just not into watching crappy wrestling, and I say good for them.
No, yeah, absolutely. I would say the two things I think the fans are tired of, or even for me personally, is watching crappy wrestling. Now, I think there's a difference between watching crappy wrestling and then watching a guy you blatantly know is new. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Even if you hear it's like this is this guy's debut match or something like that, and it's just not as great. You know what I mean?
That's a good point.
You can maybe forgive that, but when it's
and just, I think fans do.
Yeah, absolutely. They're like, oh yeah, let this guy get his feet under him. But when it's like blatant, it's the same guy you've seen for years or months or whatever it is, and they're just still. you know, like you just said, crappy wrestling, that's where they're kind of like, hey, man, you need to get it together.
And when I say crappy, you got two forms of crappy.
Yeah.
You got just he's not polished, but he's not doing anything. He or she's not doing anything. I saw him a month ago. I watched a couple matches. I see him again. He or she hasn't done one thing to change.
Right.
Then you have the non-trained guy or girl that's getting a push on every show, or the person that has experience under their belt, but you get the same thing every show. Mm-hmm. Fans get tired of that.
Yeah.
They've tolerated it. I personally, just through my research and stuff, feel like now they've put their foot down and they're showing you they don't appreciate it by not coming to the events.
And I would say the other thing that bugs me is I don't like seeing the same thing every time.
Mm.
Like, don't get me wrong. Like, you want to see guys' signature spots or maybe a signature move, or they got a signature catchphrase, right? Because that's what makes them their character a little bit. But if it's the exact same thing every time, I don't want to see that.
No, I'm with you.
Because I'll get bored real quick.
And we've talked about that in the past, about some guys just have certain matches. If you move around a lot, that helps because people don't see the same thing twice. However, here's another thing I talked about a couple podcasts ago, and I still stand behind this.
You talk about storytelling and...
Yeah, stages. Well, talent-wise...
Yeah.
When you're a talent and you work within a 40, 50-mile radius, 2 to 3 hours here and there, and you're working the same three or four promotions, mm-hmm. and you're doing the same matches, wrestling the same guys. So, and I talked about this, why should I go 3 hours away to watch you wrestle when I can wait the next week to watch you in my backyard? So now I'm not going to that promotion to watch. I'm watching you wrestle the same guy you wrestled a month ago, and I'm watching the same match.
Yeah.
That is the difference between just doing a show and actually creating a storyline, a program. That's what I like about the program advantage of a company. That I'll watch the same two guys wrestle for months on end.
Yeah.
If they're telling me there's a reason they're wrestling and I'm not watching the same match.
Yeah.
When you start booking the same guy in four different areas, I'm working in this promotion and I'm working in this promotion. I'm not going to both promotions if I'm following it. I'm just not. There's a few that I will, and that's because I believe what they're doing.
Right.
Victor Vanko is a great example of that. There's this new guy who I don't want to call him new. He's new to me because I've been researching him, Oliver Gunner. Nick Hamrick's another one that I don't think gets a lot of enough praise for what he does, because he's brought into a lot of multiples, mm-hmm. and you usually don't get the same thing with Nick Hamrick. And he's been on the PWA. He just debuted a while back, and I had a chance to wrestle him.
Yeah.
Tough dude, very tough dude. And he's believable because he's not putting on a show. It's
right.
What you get in the back is what you get in the ring. So, but you're not going to see those guys go around and do the same exact match and the same crap. They may wrestle the same guys, but they're not doing the same thing. So I think fans are picking up on that now, mm-hmm. and they're just tired of that stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
So anyway, that's my little independent soapbox. Normally we do, shout outs to independent wrestlers. I just mentioned three for you. Check them out, but we're not going to go do a deep dive today. But sometimes I always like to go back to independent wrestling. I think it's a lost art. I think it was lost, but now it's found again. And the only thing that's going to make it vibrant is the fans. And we have to stop thinking that the fans, if we build it, they'll come. You have to earn your money now.
Yeah,
I
absolutely.
Think on in the independent circuit, you have to earn your keep.
Well, no, like even with, because I remember back with us in the PWA, I remember there being a few shows where we're wrestling in front of less than 30 people.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And then we, you know, turn around and we've been in front of hundreds of people.
Yes.
So.
And when you track why did it drop off, you could have many reasons.
Oh,
but
yeah.
I can pinpoint when certain talent came in and when certain talent left. And how it affected the fans. And the fans did not want to see certain talent.
Yeah.
And they told us that by not showing up.
Right.
And it either was they just didn't like the talent or they didn't like what was going on in the ring. And that's your job as a pro wrestler to get your job done in the middle of the ring.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that's my soapbox. Let's transition on into hardcore wrestling. But before we do, I want to take a nice brief break and – check out one of our sponsors. Hey, this is the Good, the Bad, and the Wrestling, a Tony James podcast. If you're looking for top-of-the-line electronics, quality, service, delivery, all-around RC experience, you need to go to Three Brothers RC. That is threebrothersrc.com. You can see them on Facebook, and they also have a Three Brothers RC fan page. They have everything from anti-foam to yellow jackets to black jackets. They have any type of electronic need, an RC product need that you need, and you need it now. So go visit Three Brothers RC. Okay, we're back. This is the Good, the Bad, and Wrestling of Tony James podcast. Don't forget, we're on Spotify. Hit follow. We're on YouTube. Hit subscribe. You can see me at Facebook, Outlaw Tony James. And as always, I'm always telling you, I'm trying to grow Instagram at Outlaw Tony James. If it grows, it's great. If it doesn't, we'll see what we can do.
Just got to sprinkle some water on something.
That's right. You got to feed the machine. So the first topic we're going to talk about today is hardcore wrestling. And I know Jimmy's got an opinion about this. I've got some stuff I want to throw in, too. We were just on the break there. We started bebopping and scatting about it. And so we wanted to get back from break real quick because we didn't want to waste all the good stuff during the commercial. So, Jimmy, tell me about hardcore. Give me your definition. Let's get this conversation rolling.
Gotcha. No, man, I was just thinking the other day that like I do feel like hardcore wrestling or hardcore has its place in wrestling, to where it can it can bring somebody else up, it can help elevate a feud, and but I don't appreciate hardcore for the sake of hardcore. I don't want there to be blood and light tubes and all that kind of stuff for just no reason. You know what I mean? If it's not building to something. If it's not elevating a feud, if it's not during a blow off, I kind of don't think it has its place.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So there's a lot to unwrap. What is hardcore? Modern. I've talked about this before. Traditional versus modern.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can do the same thing. What's modern hardcore and traditional hardcore? I believe in today's landscape, what has happened to hardcore wrestling is the same thing that is what has happened to modern wrestling. And AEW, right?
Mm-hmm.
We were just talking about how their crowd size has gone down because you get the same match, the same guy over and over and over again. The same high spots, the same transitions. Well, guess what? That's hardcore today. You just said it. Every match is light tubes, mm-hmm. bed of nails, falling off a table, falling off a scaffold, climbing to the top of something and jumping off. Mm-hmm. If you do that every match, I don't have to stay all 6-7 matches.
Right.
I just watch the first one, or I wait till the guy I happen to like or who's mm-hmm. going to bleed like a stuck pig. I've shown some clips here on the podcast. The guy who got it with the weed whacker, and then they set him on fire, and then the fans had to put him out.
Yeah.
The guy who threw Ronald McDonald through a sea of chairs. All this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that's deathmatch stuff.
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. And you can thank Funk and Foley coming out of Japan for the exploding rings and everything else because it had its place at that time in the 90s, right?
And speaking of Foley, I feel like Foley, when he does, or at least back in the day, when he would do hardcore stuff, that was the only time you saw it on the card.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Like if you go back.
That was his thing.
Yeah. If you go back and watch. Like him and Shawn Michaels at Mind Games, right? That's like an athletic match, but there's sprinkled hardcore into that.
Right.
Like they do something off the top rope through the announce table. They do Mick Foley has a chair and Shawn Michaels reverses it on him by super kicking it in his face.
Mm.
Just little things like that, with Mick Foley and Edge at WrestleMania. You know what I mean? You would never really got to see Edge in that kind of an environment. You know what I mean? And then getting to see Edge kind of, he has to come up to Mick Foley's, I guess, brutal level. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Getting to see that character kind of transition.
Yep.
Kind of like, I know this is like not Mick Foley, but kind of like when John Cena had his I Quit match with JBL back in like, I think it was 2005.
Uh-huh.
John Cena's bleeding all over the place. It's disgusting. But you never really got to see John Cena come up to that kind of brutal level.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying they got to do it all the time, but it's the fact that the fans now know that it's within them.
Yeah.
So they know, hey, man, if it gets down and dirty, you know, Cena can go. Or, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think, I don't know if like, we ever saw light tubes and fire and exploding rings in the mainstream wrestling.
No,
here's the thing, and we may be speaking the same language, we're just thinking different eras. A hardcore, they had the hardcore title. I always felt WWF hardcore, even WCW hardcore, was traditional's way of saying a no DQ match. Anything goes, lights out, unsanctioned.
Yeah.
I grew up on, you had a match, you had a program. If you had a blow off because it was nasty, you did it in a cage.
Yeah.
As the 80s and 90s came about, then you got the trash cans and the kendo sticks. But that really isn't hardcore to me because you had a wrestling match and then they went out and got the stuff.
You had stuff sprinkled in.
Yeah, and but that's what WWF was pushing at the time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bringing out the shopping cart with all the goodies in it, and WCW was doing that. They were calling it hardcore because ECW started the whole thing, right, with what they were doing.
Mm-hmm. Go get the tables.
Right, but you got to remember, barbed wire matches
–
60s, 70s, and 80s, where they took the ropes down and put the barbed wire up. That was happening a lot. The exploding rings, the light tubes, the blood and guts, that all came from Japan and made its way into a niche here in modern wrestling, which still goes on today.
Because I feel like you had guys way back, but like Bruiser Brody.
But,
and,
right.
And what's his name? Ah, oh, man, I feel bad now. He wears like red pants, crap. I'm going to have to come back.
Okay, but here's the thing with Bruiser Brody.
Oh, Abdullah the Butcher.
Yeah.
There we go.
Here's the thing with those guys.
Yeah.
That was inserted into who they were. Abdullah had the fork on him all the time. When you wrestled Abdullah, someone was bleeding.
Yeah.
Because that was the only thing he had.
That was his thing.
Bruiser Brody had the chain and was crazy. But he didn't do, like, his matches weren't centered around light tubes, blood, and guts.
Yeah.
Bruiser Brody was that guy that everybody knew he couldn't be beat, but you got in the ring and you were going to pay for it for thinking you could get in there with him.
Mm-hmm.
I was just watching a match, and I'm going to – this is a little Easter egg, so to speak, from one of my future podcasts in the AWA. The AWA brought Bruiser Brody in, and – they put him up against guys that had no business acting like they were tough. And he'd let you know by kicking you in the face. But he didn't always bring in a chair and crack people and gouge them open. Abdullah in Puerto Rico did all the time. When he fought Brody, it was guaranteed. He had a brief feud with superstar Billy Graham, even on TV. There was a lot of beatdowns. But as I define hardcore, light tubes, every match, beds and nails, falling off something. Because, you know, ECW started jumping off the balcony and throwing guys into tables.
The scaffolding stuff.
Is that really hardcore? Or is that just a show that a match that culminated into, okay, I've had enough of you. We're having a tables, ladders, chairs match, and I'm just going to go up 60 tables and jump through it and hope that I hit my spot.
Right.
See the difference?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if that show had six matches of 60 levels of tables, there's nothing else you could call but hardcore.
Yeah.
So I think it's just defining it. I don't know I know hardcore's still around today.
Yeah.
I think it's a dying animal, in my opinion.
I think, I would probably agree with that, because there's still guys that are out there doing it right now. I don't have their names in the forefront of my mind, but it's more. I want to say it's just more of the fans just want to see the carnage of it.
It's like a bad wreck. You want to drive by and take a picture.
Because if you know you're seeing a guy that's just doing that stuff, you know what I mean? You're just going to see how crazy it's going to get.
Yeah.
Like, is he going to get something? Is he going to get a staple gun to the face?
Yes.
You know,
here's the thing.
It's just that kind of level of stuff.
That clip I showed of the Weed Whacker, it was cool and everybody loved it. And then he got on fire. Then it got real quick. And then they started dousing him with water. I said, if that match is real, well, I'm dousing kerosene on him and then I win. Because that's the point, isn't it? To win the match. And if you're going to say, legally, I can do anything I want to you and not get in trouble for it and not have a guilty conscience over it, then that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
And I think that's the problem with the hardcore wrestling, right? We are spoiled to the point where, and I think you made this comment when we were off the air about current product. It should mean something. We should see that journey of the wrestler getting to that point to where he has to go across the line.
Yeah.
Right?
That's what I agree with. Yeah.
Yes. You want to see that transformation. Edge tried to do that in the Hell in the Cell with Finn Balor, right?
Yeah.
He tried to show that I'm going to a dark place, right?
Right, yeah.
Now, that was a legit head wound to Finn Balor, right?
Because they had to stop. Didn't they stop that match for a few minutes?
The camera went off of him. I know
for
that.
A minute, yeah, because they had to. I guess they threw in. I thought what I heard was they threw a bunch of numbing
lotion
on him and then stapled it really quick just to hold it. And then he finished the match.
So, to me, and you made this comment too, they went from blood to no blood. And that stuff, when it's done the hard way, is legit, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when you got guys like Cody Rhodes and Brock Lesnar and these other guys that are wrestling stiff, Gunther, and you're seeing the stiffness like, oh, my gosh, I can't believe they're going to the next level in these matches. I don't define that as hardcore. That's just a different level of wrestler you got to deal with. I think going into a match and you already see 100 light tubes, a bed of nails, and the rings jack to be blown up, that is the match.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care who's going through the light tubes. It's the light tubes busting. It's seeing all the blood on the guy's back. It's the ring exploding.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're going to see. You're not going to see the guys tell a story
because
there's no story to tell.
No, absolutely. Because I've done a couple of what you were kind of saying during the break there, where it's just a kind of no DQ, no holds barred, and I was okay with doing it. This was in another promotion, but it was the fact that we had kind of told a story leading up to it, and we were the only match on the card doing that.
Yes.
So I was like, this is our little, yes, you're going to see weapons in this match kind of thing. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, because you had, on that card, you had, you know, tag matches, you know, big guy, little guy matches, the heavyweight title match, and then you had this grudge match that had weapons in it.
Yes.
So, do I think that we could have took some stuff out of that? Yeah, probably. You know what I mean? Because there was all kinds of stuff. There was bricks and cookie sheets and anything you can get under that ring. but in my head, that isn't... Every time you see Jimmy Fahrenheit, it isn't that.
Right, right.
That was like a legit maybe two or three times in my whole career that I was like, let's just hit each other with everything but the kitchen sink.
Mm.
And like I said, that was the only match like that on the card. If every match was no holds barred, then nobody would have cared.
I think you got levels and people confuse them. I think you have triple threat matches, no DQs, cage matches, lumberjack matches. Then you have hardcore matches.
See, when I hear no DQ.
Yeah. Anything goes.
No, but I guess when I hear no DQ in my head, I don't think of weapons. I think of just getting to do all this. And I know this is going to sound dumb, but I know how, like, when I think of DQ, I think of all the stuff the ref would tell you to stop doing.
Right, right.
But I know when the ref would tell you to stop hitting people with chairs. I know. But to me, it's kind of... I guess it would be everything I would do in a regular match.
But your buddy's allowed to run down and crack you and not get in trouble for it.
Somebody can run down and do that. Or I could choke somebody on the ropes longer
absolutely.
Than I would want to. Or I can
with you.
Or I could dick kick somebody.
Yep.
That. I don't immediately go to, let's bust out all the stuff.
Right.
That can't
I'm with you on that.
Yeah. Or it would even be something like if me and the guy were fighting on the outside of the ring. The 10 count doesn't matter.
Yes.
That's what I think of when I hear no DQ.
I think that's what the original definition was.
And see, that's so misconstrued because then some people are like...
Well, then no DQ turned into hardcore.
Yeah.
And then hardcore turned into deathmatch.
What is no holds barred? Is that just there?
Well, then you have the Texas deathmatch where... you can pin, but the pin doesn't count. Then you give them a 10 count to see if they get up. The no holds barred, I'm assuming no holds barred is basically no DQ.
Yeah. And then like last man standing is basically no DQ with just answering a 10 count.
Right.
That's all it is.
There's a means to an end.
Yeah.
Hardcore in those matches then got in shades of gray.
Mm-hmm.
And then I don't know how people, when they shouldn't think of death matches when they think of hardcore. Death match
is its own thing.
To me, is the light tubes, the barbed wire ropes. The
baseball bats.
Fire. All that, all to it, me, yeah. is death match stuff.
Yeah.
Right? I know Mick Foley, with wrapping the bat with barbed wire,
mm-hmm.
kind of brought that death match influence into the WWE without really doing a death match.
Right.
That was his thing. It got over. And you're right. Not everybody did what Mick Foley did.
Yeah.
The problem is on the independence scene, I don't need to. That's easy. I'll just get a bunch of cookie sheets and light this on fire. And
you're influencing a bunch of guys to think that's all you got to do.
Yeah, and I'm with you on that. And that goes back to fans aren't stupid.
Mm-hmm.
They're not. And even if you can pack the house with a death match, are they really coming to see the talent or are they coming to see the carnage? There's two different things.
They're coming to see that. If that would have been a Jimmy Fahrenheit, Tony James feuding for 3 months, and then we finally get to they're having a tables match or whatever, right? They're coming to see us, and they're coming to see the feud. They're not coming to see a tables match.
Right, right.
You know?
But the guys wielding the stuff, not the stuff itself.
But if we just randomly threw two wrestlers against the wall and said tables match, they're like, well, let's go see, watch somebody get thrown through a table.
Right, and, you know, to kind of wrap it up, I got an example for you. I did a triple threat match where it was no DQ, okay?
I thought all triple threat matches were no DQ.
I'm not a triple threat guy, so they had to say, Tony, you're allowed to do what you want.
Oh,
I
cool.
said, well, thank you very much. So I brought multiple cowbells and ropes with me.
Yeah.
I put them on each corner in case I needed them because now I'm allowed to use them, right?
Right. Yep.
I stuffed powder down into my trunks in case I needed to blind somebody. But other than that, I'm wrestling.
Yeah.
One of my opponents stashed some kendo sticks under the ring. Here's the thing. We didn't go right to those.
Right.
I do know as soon as the bell rang, I punched them both in the mouth. Drug them to a corner and then wrapped the rope around their neck and tied them to the post so they couldn't move and beat the crap out of them. Why wouldn't you? I'm not going to wrestle 20 minutes in a triple threat, no DQ.
Yeah.
I want to get out of there quick. It was a story that we were telling, meaning I had fought these guys over and over and over again, and we finally said, this has got to end. We'll do a triple threat.
Right.
Last guy, you know how it works. And then finally they bring the kendo sticks out and the fans went crazy when I got my butt smacked with them. That goes to what you're saying. There's a means to an end when it comes to using that stuff. That was not a hardcore match.
No.
I don't want it to be called a hardcore match, and it definitely wasn't a death match. Now, with that being said, it takes a special guy or girl to do those death match.
No, yeah.
Because you are, that's legit, man.
Yeah.
It's a controlled burn is what it is. Yeah, I'm lighting you on fire, but I supposedly have control of it.
Right. No, yeah.
I'm not interested in that stuff.
Because I've bled the hard way a couple times.
Mm-hmm.
And
same here.
And it's never been to that kind of a level.
No.
Like, that's a...
You got to be committed to that. That's your life.
And it's the thing that I don't get is I feel like on the independent scene, guys are doing that to each other with, like, no payoff.
Right.
Like, I'm not trying to say I'm getting paid hundreds of thousands of dollars to do what I do, but it's why would you put your body through all that, like, to that level, you know what I mean? To just have fans not even know who you are.
And here's the thing. I want to see, at the end of the day, whoever watches my stuff, I want to have quality matches.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be known for what I did in the ring, not what I used in the ring.
No, yeah, that's right.
If they want to be known for, at the end of their career, if they're doing this, even if it's in front of five people, I was a deathmatch wrestler, here's proof, here's my scars to prove it. If that's their badge to wear, then God bless you, pay your bills. That's just not my thing. And I think there's a small group of fans that want to see that, but at the end of the day, those fans are leaving. They don't give two craps about you and what you're doing after the match and the hours it takes to get yourself cleaned up just to get home. Yeah. I'm with you on that. Hogan always said it, and I'll always repeat it. It's the money and the miles. Mm-hmm. Who makes the most money traveling the less miles? And the only way you can do that is if you keep yourself in shape and you're in longevity. The fans dig you for you.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm with you on that. So hardcore wrestling, who's your top hardcore guy?
I could do like a little Mount Rushmore.
Do one.
Do a little Mount Rushmore. It'd be Mick Foley for sure.
Yep.
Terry Funk.
Yep.
I would probably... See, I had a couple of these in my head, but then a lot of these guys, here's the thing, is like, when I think of these guys, they're floating into deathmatch stuff.
Okay.
And I'm not always about that.
Right. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm ignorant when it comes to hardcore because I never got into it.
Because I could just name a ton of dudes. But then there's some dudes on that list that
So let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Terry Funk's going to be my guy just because I know he traditionally wasn't a hardcore guy, but he did move into the hardcore realm, right?
Yeah.
So I'm picking – I love Terry Funk. So I would also – is Sabu? Would Sabu be a hardcore
Sabu
guy?
Sabu would be,
So I'm a Sabu guy. There was something about his look with his scars, and I just dug Sabu, okay? So Sabu and Terry are up there. I'll give Mick Foley his props, and then I'm struggling – to be honest with you.
But see, that's where it kind of floats into the others, guys. That
Tommy Dreamer.
Yeah. Yeah.
How about that?
Yeah, Tommy Dreamer, and you got the Sandman.
Yeah, Sandman.
But then you get into where you got...
New Jack.
New Jack. And see, I don't like New Jack. And everybody hates on me.
But isn't he hardcore?
Yeah.
Do you give him props for what he did? You don't have to like him.
Yeah.
You don't have to take him home for dinner.
There's moments with his stuff I'm like, nah. Like, and I know, like, where he, I guess, for me, it's when he actually tells the stories, and they're all personal, I guess. Where he's like, I bladed this guy too deep on purpose, or I...
Oh, okay. Or like, but you know what? That's the other guy's fault for wrestling him and allowing him to do it.
Yeah. And then, or where he tased the guy in a match.
Yeah.
And then just stuff like that, where I'm kind of like, you know what, man? I'm just not about it.
But those guys are.
Yeah.
And some of those guys walk around saying, yeah, I was tased by New Jack, and I think it's cool. So,
yeah.
All right. Well, hey, that's hardcore for you. If you're hardcore, stick around. If you're a hardcore good, bad, and wrestling fan, we're gonna transition into tag team wrestling. And I might even have a special match at the end of the podcast for you. Until then, let's check in on a sponsor. This is the Good, the Bad, and the Wrestling, the Tony James Podcast. Southpaw Boxing Club Hilliard. You can reach them at southpawboxingclub.com. You can give them a call at 740-973-4869. Classes, individual need, even for the kids, no better time than the present to start them early. They have everything you need for your health maintaining experience. There's nothing like going into the gym, breaking a sweat, putting on the gloves, cracking the heavy bag, and improving your life. Check it out. Southpaw Boxing Club Hilliard. That is southpawboxingclub.com, 740-973-4869. Hey, we are back. This is the Good, the Bad, and the Wrestling of Tony James Podcast. Now we're going to transition into tag team wrestling. Tag team wrestling in general. I've got a lot to talk about on this. I'll try to keep my comments close to the vest and not long-winded, but I do have an opinion on tag team wrestling. But once again, Jimmy, want to talk about tag team wrestling. So, Jimmy, tell me what's on your mind.
Yeah, absolutely, man. Nah, man, I was going to say, like, back in the day, I actually didn't really like tag team wrestling, to be honest with you. Like, when I first got into it, or first started watching wrestling. But, it's just the older I get, the more tag team wrestling is just kind of chaotic. There's all kinds of stuff going on.
When you think of tag team wrestling, who's your team?
Ooh, jeez. That's a rough question, Tony.
Who's your team?
There's so many teams, man. Jeez. Tony, that's rough, man.
I got one.
You just have one off the top?
The Road Warriors.
Yeah, see, that's what I was going to say. Like,
that's my team.
That's just the team?
That's the
team. All day, every day?
All day, every day. And I have a philosophy behind it, too. And I stack it all on the Road Warriors. Absolutely.
Gotcha. I mean, if you're going to ask me what my team was that, like, got me into it and kept me going, I'd probably have to say the Hardy Boys.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they're a legit tag team.
Oh, yeah.
They're not two singles put together.
Nope, yeah.
Right?
I was going to say that, man. I don't hate it when two singles are put together because sometimes that can work out. I hate it when it's two feuding guys that they put together.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm talking about? Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah. That's what I don't like. Well, like when when Shawn Michaels and John Cena were wrestling at WrestleMania 23, they were the tag team champions. And then they're wrestling at WrestleMania 23.
Oh, I see what
like
you're
that
saying.
Stuff.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
I think it was one. I can't remember who it was. It was Chris Benoit and Kurt Angle. But they were feuding, and then they put them in a tag team to go fight for. And then they won the SmackDown tag titles back in 02, I think. Just making people feud or people that are feuding, and then making them tag teams.
Yeah, well, and the Mega Powers was the opposite of that. They were a tag, and then they broke up and feuded. Sometimes I'm not a big fan of having a single title holder being in a tag team because, in a way, why are you doing that? Like Ultimate Warrior, when he was the champ, they put him in six-mans with Demolition. Mm-hmm. That's telling me that he should be able to stand alone. Why is he messing around in six-mans, right?
Right.
Savage was the champ, and then he started tagging with Hogan. I know where they were going with that. I wasn't a big Mega Powers fan. Mm-hmm. I liked Hogan as a standalone. So tag team, to me, they've got to be a legit tag team. Like the Rock and Roll Express, one body, one mind. Midnight Express, same thing. So that's when I think of tag team, I'm thinking I've got one unit. Or do we have any legit? Because it's like current day wrestling, they're either thrown together or it's a legit tag team, but then they want to go single.
I mean, until recently, I would probably say the Usos.
Okay, yeah, you're right. They're probably the ones that stayed true.
Yeah, because they've been a tag the whole time.
Yeah, they've stayed true to being a tag team, definitely. Yeah, definitely. What tag teams, like I've got my whole mindset, and you got to remember, I started later following wrestling, so I got a different view of it. Are you more of a traditional era or a modern era tag guy? I know Hardys would be considered probably more modern, don't you think?
I'd say more modern.
Not modern as in today's day, because you're talking Hardys are, what, 90s, midnight, mid to late 90s? But that was definitely a different time than traditional.
Yeah, absolutely. I would always say I enjoyed watching the Dudleys. I liked it when it was Shelton Benjamin and Charlie Haas.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Just for the antics, DX. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, now you're getting into factions, right?
Okay.
Now think of this. Tag teams actually, with the Four Horsemen was probably one of your first factions, right? And then they had a tag team champs out of that. They always had tag team belts.
Mm-hmm.
And then the NWO came along and the Outsiders had the belts. But factions seem to be more popular nowadays than tag teams.
Would you count the New Day as a faction?
I wouldn't.
Just a team?
They're another group that stayed true because there were three of them. One could go off and be the world title holder and the other two could tag.
Yeah.
Because, the Usos, they ended up being part of the bloodline, right?
Bloodline,
but I still consider the Usos a So
they're still a tag team.
That faction thing is taking over the world, so to speak. And I get kind of tired of the faction. Everybody's in a faction now.
Mm-hmm.
In NXT, everybody's on a team.
Well, that was kind of like in the late 90s. It was kind of a lot of factions.
Yep.
You had DX and the NWO and the Nation and
the LWO. Everybody was in it. Everybody was gang warfare is basically what it was. And that was the hottest thing.
Mm-hmm.
So the way I look at tags is going way back when, in the way back machine, I believe the hotbed, the place for tag teams was the NWA, okay? Mm-hmm. I'm talking 70s, definitely the 80s into the 90s before, and then it turned into WCW, and then it kind of dissipated with tag teams, even though they still created legit tag teams. AWA was the tweener. They would put single guys together. Like if you go back and look at the history of the AWA tag teams, there's fewer real legit tag teams than there are single guys being put together. And then the WWWF into the WWF, all they did was throw single guys together and create a tag team. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, the WWF really didn't have a powerhouse tag team division until 86. NWA, I felt, was running all – you want to go somewhere and watch tag team, you go to the NWA, mm-hmm. traditional NWA. Perfect example, the first Crockett Cup tournament in 1986. Mm-hmm. They had every promotion except the WWF, and we know why. But it was you got to go back and watch that. It's great stuff. The WWF – The only real legitimate tag team they had was the U.S. Express, Barry Windham, Mike Rotundo. Where'd they come from? Florida. Florida's part of what? The NWA. Barry Windham, Mike Rotundo, no wonder, right? So how'd they get the belts? They got the belts from Adonis and Dick Murdoch. Two single guys thrown together. Why? Because they had to beat Tony Atlas and Rocky Johnson. Right. Two single guys. Pardon me.
You good?
Two single guys thrown together. Why'd they throw Rocky Johnson and Tony Atlas together? To take the belts off the Samoans, a true tag team, one of the very few true tag teams in the WWF at that time.
Yep.
So going into 84, you had Atlas and Johnson win the titles. Then they threw two single guys together to beat them. And then you finally have the U.S. Express. Now, about 86, before WrestleMania 2, you ended up getting the Killer Bees, the Hart Foundation, yep. the British Bulldogs, Sheik and Volkov, right?
Yeah.
There's four big ones right there.
Yeah, that's
they started creating legitimate tag teams. Mm-hmm. NWA was already off and running at that point. Yeah. You were already into the Russian rock and roll feud, Midnight Express rock and roll feud, which all started in the Mid-South, mm-hmm. Mid-South being another place where tag teams were big. But I still consider that part as under the NWA umbrella. So, and then you had the AWA just kind of sitting out there as a tweener.
Yeah.
I still felt that, you know, the Rockers,
yep.
Bad Company came from the AWA. Mm-hmm. They were just always kind of hovering around with tag teams. And then something happened in the 90s. I think WWF stayed true to tag team, but I just don't think the tag team divisions had enough bite in them. NWA turned to WCW and they started doing gimmick pay-per-views and, you know, they brought in some really cool tag teams, Gordy and Williams, and they were tagging. Once again, they started tagging singles guys together to make it mean something.
Yeah.
The Steiners.
Oh yeah. The Steiners.
They're an exception to the rule, right? Mm-hmm. However, the Road Warriors,
yeah,
1985, AWA, they beat and win the tag team belts. In my opinion, the Road Warriors was the AWA's answer to Hulk Hogan, mm-hmm. okay? They should have, AWA, Vern Gagne, and of course he knows best, right? That's why the AWA went bankrupt. Vern Gagne should have given the Road Warriors what they wanted. Stay with me, sign this contract, you're mine. Keep the tag belts, can keep your Japan deal. We'll cross you with the NWA once in a while, mm-hmm. but you're my guys. The Road Warriors, I'm telling you, the AWA would have been totally different if they would have kept the Road Warriors. Once they dropped the belts to Steve Regal, right, and Gorgeous Jimmy, and they came to the NWA, great move for the NWA. And there's a little known nugget behind that. When the NWA and the AWA did a cross promotional in 85, Jim Crockett's brother, right? Jimmy. Mm-hmm. It was Jim Crockett's promotion. And who was the guy who was with Schiavone? That was David Crockett. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
David Crockett was in the back going around to AWA guys going, hey, you want to come work for me? Hey, you want to come work for me? And Vern Gagne was like, well, we won't be working together anymore because you're bird dogging my talent. And then next thing you know, you got the Road Warriors on NWA TV.
Yeah.
And they wanted their Japan deal. And so that was working. To me, the Road Warriors didn't ever have to go to the WWF to make their name.
No, yeah.
Never.
No.
They didn't know what to do with them when they got there.
Then they changed their name.
Legion of Doom.
Legion of Doom, yeah.
Well, they were always the Legion of Doom, the Road Warriors.
Yeah, yeah.
Because the original Legion of Doom was Jake the Snake Roberts, King Kong Bundy, and the Road Warriors. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, they never knew what to do with the Road Warriors. To me, the Road Warriors were the end-all be-all when it came to tag team wrestling. And I love the Midnight Express and the Rock and Roll Express, but it's the same thing with Hulk Hogan. He was the face. The Road Warriors were the face.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I picked the Road Warriors when I think of tag teams, I'm thinking of the Road Warriors. Now, you're a little bit different because of decades of when you started watching. So what was it about the Hardys that got you rolling with them?
I think it was just all the energy they brought to the ring and all the – it kind of goes to the fact that, like, they weren't the biggest dudes either.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then, you know, they're getting in there with the Dudley Boys and the APA and a lot of other bigger dudes and still making it happen and doing creative offense and stuff like that. Because what you were saying a little bit ago about how tag team wrestling kind of, I want to say it kind of fell off a little bit in the probably mid-thousands. Because you had tag team wrestling, and then you went to the 90s where all the tag team wrestling was kind of gimmick matched.
Yeah.
And then everybody thought it was sweet. It was still awesome. And then they took all the gimmick matches away. And then it was kind of like, well, now we don't think tag team wrestling is as cool.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because I still remember in the early, probably like from 2005 to 2010, a lot of goofy tag teams like Deuce and Domino. I liked Eminem, though.
mm-hmm.
I just thought they just had cool offense and stuff. But it's just a lot of goofy tag teams in that thousands era. Cause you had like Billy and Chuck, the Dicks,
mm-hmm.
the Spirit Squad, just that kind of stuff. And then you got like how you were saying, like, I know DX is kind of like a faction or whatever, but you know, they're given, we were talking about a little bit ago, you know, Shawn Michaels and John Cena held the tag belts. Why?
Right.
You know, Triple H and Shawn Michaels get the tag belts, like, kind of why.
Right.
Edge and Randy Orton rated RKO. Why? Like, you had no actual tag teams. You just took these stars, put them together for 6 months, whatever, did some stuff, and then bailed out.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. I think we got some more now because you got, like, DIY and the Revival.
Yeah, yeah.
And the Usos and the New Day.
But those are guys that hone their craft and believe and can get the tag team presentation over. Tag teams at some point just decided, hey, let's throw these two popular guys together and promote a pay-per-view. Oh, no, all four in a ring. Like Hogan can be accused of that. He teamed with Rodman. They went against certain guys, and it was a tag team, but it really wasn't. It's how you present the tag team.
Yeah.
So I agree with you. In the mid-2000s when they had tag teams, the presentation, it wasn't a big deal to win the tag belts.
No, it wasn't.
And then there's so many different types of tag belts.
Oh, I forgot about Paul London and Brian Kendrick.
Yeah.
No, yeah, I like them too.
Well, the nice thing about the smaller guys tagging, they can do things to create one big guy to go against big guys.
Right.
So it was legitimate to believe mm-hmm. that. I just felt like promotions stopped promoting true tag team wrestling.
Yeah.
And on the independent scene, it's so hard to – guys, it's hard to keep guys to want to do tag team stuff. And then you got to find tag teams,
yeah.
right? It's hard in a promotion to have a tag team division worthy of not just throwing guys together.
Yeah.
But I feel that it's the Road Warriors. And listen, we can argue in-ring performance all day long.
Mm-hmm.
They got better and more believable as they got experience and they were doing more what you would say current type of moves. But I didn't care. It was about winning.
Yeah.
And it meant something if you got one over on the Road Warriors.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And then they ended up getting jobbed out all the time in the WWF. But before that, it was something to be in the ring with the Road Warriors. Same thing with Rock and Roll Express, the Russians, all of them, to me, meant something in tag team wrestling. And nowadays, I think it's just – like, you got Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn, they have both belts. It does nothing for me.
Yeah.
I tuned in to see them win the titles. I thought, you know, I want to see that.
Right.
And I always wondered, why do they keep pushing the Usos? I'm getting sick. Well, now you know why. There's no other tag teams.
Yeah.
No true tag teams. Oh, they all left. Right? And then AEW doesn't know how to book the freaking tag teams.
Mm-hmm.
As something I want to see the tag champs.
Yeah.
It was just belts made to put on the Young Bucks. So they can say they are the end-all, be-all when it comes to tag team wrestling. Mm-hmm. I don't give a crap. So tag team is and then working a tag match is totally
– it's totally different.
If you want people to enjoy a tag match, you better know what you're doing.
Yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, I was going to say there is a right and wrong way to do that.
Yeah. So –
it can turn into just four guys having singles matches.
Right.
Really quick. Yeah.
Yeah. Even if they got the same gear and everything, you got to know what you're doing.
What's your opinion on that? Because I hear through independent wrestling, I hear like a bunch of different conflicts on that. If you're in a tag team, should you have matching stuff, like matching gear?
Well,
I don't think you necessarily have to. I just think
if I'm in a tag with somebody and we say we're going to tag and we're going to be introduced as a tag team.
So you have your own tag name.
We are the blank.
Okay.
And we're introduced and our first match is here. Boom. I think we should look. We should have a theme.
Or you should have something complimentary.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
If I'm a single guy, and I've been wrestling single, and you're a single guy, and you've been wrestling single, and we've already have our personas down,
yeah.
And then we start tagging consistently for a while, like you and I do.
Right.
Right? We can do I do little things to match what you do.
No, yeah.
But we still – I think it's okay for us still to keep our personality mm-hmm. and tag together because, once again, people – want to see that,
yeah.
Right? I think if we started dressing alike, mm-hmm. It probably would take away from why we're tagging in the first place.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because it was the way our tag team was formed.
Yeah.
If we would have went away for 6 months and came back as the blank mm-hmm. and had same gear and did the same thing and you never saw us in a singles match, then I think that's cool to do. But once again, in independence, sometimes you got to break tag teams up to have singles matches. Mm-hmm. And so that benefits us. So I know in my mind, when we tag, I have certain gear I wear. And when I'm single, I have certain gear I wear.
Yeah.
And it's a subliminal message to let people know we're tagging.
Yeah.
Right? Because we talk. Hey, what are you wearing? Let's kind of.
Let's try.
Let's look the same without looking the same.
Right. You're just complimenting.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I always get it to where a lot of people are like, you got to have the exact same stuff. And I'm like, no. I was going to say for most of the – with all the other guys I've tagged with, we always just kind of either did something to compliment or just kind of maybe had like the same T-shirt
mm-hmm.
or something like that.
Or you were lucky enough to tag with a guy that kind of had the same color scheme that you did anyway.
Yeah, or – just something like that but you could tell when we were both in the ring with each other, we were like a unit.
That's more important to me than how you look.
Yeah. Like you could tell like, hey, that's that tag team.
Yeah. And the interaction between the guys as a team.
Yeah.
And I know with us, our gear has kind of evolved over the years. Mm-hmm. Right. So even if we look like a hodgepodge, it actually fits and works mm-hmm. because once again, how we wrestle and how we look in a singles match is totally different than how we look and how we wrestle in a tag. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the important part to draw people in on that. So, Hardy Boys, I'm Road Warriors, you're Hardy Boys. Let's do a Mount Rushmore of tag teams.
All right. I would say Legion of Doom.
There you go.
I would say the Hardy Boys.
You better have them on yours.
And if we're going off of just like a pure...
I'm talking all time.
All time, I would...
To modern day.
I would probably have to throw the Usos in there.
Okay.
Because they've never, bailed from being a tag team. They've had multiple tag team titles. They've evolved their characters over time. They don't look the same as when they, mm-hmm. First debuted. And I think the tag team that actually has the record for the most tag team titles is the Dudley Boys.
Yeah.
At like 20-something ranks over multiple companies.
Yeah.
So I would probably have to throw them in there.
Now, you're basing it on fact rather than personal like. Am I right? Or do you like all those guys as much as you?
No, I mean, don't get me wrong. I like all those guys. But like the Legion of Doom was completely dominant. The Hardy Boys would probably be, and don't get me wrong, the Hardy Boys have won tags everywhere mm-hmm. they've went and, you know, they've evolved over time, or Matt has.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the Dudleys I'm probably basing just on stats, and same thing with the Usos.
Okay.
Because if right now, if I say, like, D-Von or Bubba Ray Dudley, you're thinking of a tag team.
Right.
You know what I mean? If yeah. I say Matt or Jeff, you might for a second think of a single star. You know what I mean? But if I said Hawk or Animal, you're thinking of a tag team.
Absolutely.
If I said Jimmy or Jay, you're thinking of a tag team. If I say Shawn Michaels, you're not immediately thinking of DX. You know what
or
I mean?
The Midnight Rockers.
Or the Midnight Rockers, yeah.
Well, if you say Marty and Sean,
yeah,
you do.
Yeah, if you say Marty and Sean, you do. Yeah, yeah. There you go. But like with if I say Kevin Nash, you're not immediately thinking
no.
NWO.
Right.
You know, or
Outsiders.
Or if I say Randy Orton, you're not immediately thinking of a Rated RKO. It's just certain things in there.
Right.
But there are tag teams where if you say one of those dudes' names, that's a tag team. That's yeah. like, bam, they did this together.
Yeah, they tried to split up the Road Warriors many times and it just didn't work. They are a tag team. They will always be a tag team. In my opinion, they'll always be the greatest tag team for what tag team stands for. Now, I'm going to be a little bit different on my Mount Rushmore.
All right.
Just because I'm going with what attracted me to wrestling.
Okay.
So Road Warriors number one.
Yeah.
And that'd be to split my Mount Rushmore. Each there's going to be four faces, but the face is going to be split in half with each guy. So that first one's going to look awesome anyway with the Road Warriors. Then I'm going U.S. Express, Rotundo, and Wyndham. You got to watch their stuff, man. They were awesome. Why were they awesome? They came out of Florida. Why did they come out of Florida? Because they're NWA bound, baby. I'm telling you, they Vince missed the boat on this. He shouldn't have let Barry leave. They could have had a long run and it really established the tag team division, but of course then they had the Bulldogs and everybody was happy. So the Road Warriors, U.S. Express. Now here's where we're getting a little, we're going to get a little, you know, sticky. The argument, I liked the Rock and Roll Express. I really did.
Yeah.
Wasn't a big fan, but I liked what they did. Same thing with the Midnight Express. But the Midnight Express, what they were able to do with leaving Dennis Condrey and going to Sweet Stan Lane, I would almost put the Midnight Express as my number three.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, I got to get a modern day tag in there because
okay.
I could go Heart Foundation. I love the Heart Foundation.
That's true.
So I could list them and be muddy in the water. Mm-hmm. But when you do a Mount Rushmore, you got to have some gumption and just go with four and live with it.
Yeah.
So I can do all the hey, I love this team. I love that team. But I'm going U.S. Express, Road Warriors, Midnight Express, and then I'm going to go FTR. Because if you watch them,
mm-hmm.
when utilized properly, I think they're probably the greatest modern-day tag team. Why they're not being used, why I would have been a free agent if I was on that team, and I would have given my services out to anybody calling me, and I would have made my way. They could have made just as much money, in my opinion,
mm-hmm.
Going to within the different federations, going to Japan, doing other things. So that I would put them up there. The Midnight Express slot, that is a rotating slot, in my opinion. People are going to go, U.S. Express? Are you kidding me? I know. You'd probably take them out and put the Hart Foundation in and keep the Midnight Express in. But the impact that Barry Windham and Mike Rotundo had on the tag team division in the mid-80s, because they were also used as public figures for NBC.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of promo spots and publications where Windham and Rotundo were being used. I think they're underrated. They ended up going to Wrestle Rock 86 and wrestled for AWA briefly, went back down to Florida, made their way to the NWA and never tagged again. But Rotundo ended up going to the Varsity Club, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then Wyndham, of course, went to the Four Horsemen. So that I just think awesome tag when you're thinking of that. All the others, you know, Demolition, great tag team, Powers of Pain.
I forgot about Demolition.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, but once again, in the WWF, their tag team division didn't take off till 86 and really wasn't rolling until 87, 88.
Yeah.
So NWA was so far ahead of everyone else when it come to tag team wrestling. And then AWA, They had a great shot and blew it. They had the Freebirds.
Oh, yeah. Freebirds, yeah.
Yeah, they had them. They had a lot of great tag teams. And even World Class was up there. And then, you know, everybody just went away from tag team wrestling. So it's a shame. And I'm going to give NWA one more prop here before we finish up. They were the master of the six-man. Yeah. They pushed the six-man tag.
Yeah.
Dusty and the Road Warriors, the Russians. What a great way to introduce people into something and giving them some kind of title. Mm-hmm. I just thought that's when I first started going, oh, six-man. Oh, that means something.
Yeah.
So then they started pushing six-man matches on the Saturday shows, on the house shows. And then you'd have one here or there on a pay-per-view. Sweet. It means something. And it wasn't until Survivor Series, mm-hmm. right, at the end of 87 when the WWF got on board and went, hey, we're going to one-up you. Let's do the Survivor Series. Yeah. And then they did a Survivor Series with tag teams, and you had the whole freaking ring covered in guys. You couldn't see what was going on inside.
Ten dudes on each side.
Yeah, and it's about time, but it's a lost art, and I'm with you on that. You got any parting words for us, Jimmy?
Other than plug in the PWA's next show.
Hey.
We got, July 15th at the Fairfield County Fairgrounds.
Mm.
We got a stacked card, all kinds of good matches. And don't forget to come see the Outlaw, Tony James, and from the center of the earth, Jimmy Fahrenheit, tag team champions. And we are defending those belts. And
we don't know against who yet.
We don't know against who, but I feel bad for whoever gets in the ring with us.
Absolutely. And by the time this podcast drops, I don't know if we'll know, but we always defend our titles when given an opportunity. And we're going to do our best to uphold tag team tradition and whatever you have on your Mount Rushmore.
And wear the same clothes.
We'll be close, but I don't know. We don't roll that way. But so I've got a little something for you. I'll put at the end of this. I hope you enjoy it. Long live tag team wrestling. Hey, you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. God is good, and we will see you at the matches.
Weighing in at a combined weight of 520 pounds, Precious Paul Ellering presents the Legion of Doom, Animal and Hawk, the Road Warriors.
5 minutes going by.
Way to go, Animal!
This event, ladies and gentlemen, the second of the quarterfinal elimination.